HarperCollins and Harper Audio present His Masterly Pen, A Biography of Jefferson the Writer by Fred Kaplan. Read by Mark Bramhall. A note before we begin. For notes on the text, additional reading materials, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/his-masterly-pen. In Memoriam, Rhoda Ackerson Weir, 1937 to 2021. Mr. Jefferson had the reputation of a masterly pen. He had been chosen a delegate in Virginia in consequence of a very handsome public paper which he had written for the House of Burgesses, which had given him the character of a fine writer. John Adams, Autobiography. The Shining Traces of His Pen. James Madison, Letters. Getting its history wrong is part of being a nation. Ernest Renan. Preface. Thomas Jefferson is the most controversial founding father for our times, above all due to his relationship with slavery. He inherited slaves, bought and sold slaves, and, after the death of his wife, had six children by Sally Hemings, a slave woman who was a half-sister to his wife. It is that part of his life that we condemn today. It is useful to keep in mind, however, that Jefferson was also hated by many of his contemporaries as a Jacobin revolutionary, a populist demagogue, an agnostic or atheist, a slaveholder who believed in liberty in principle but not in practice, who preached against big government and centralized power, but did not hesitate to use it in the interests of his policies, and a man whose vision of America's future minimized banking, industry, and urbanization. All of which is to say, Jefferson has always been a controversial figure, and our attitudes toward him will be divided for as long as we study and reflect on our history. Indeed, his legacy, especially his Declaration of Independence, which says that all men are created equal, is so central to the American experience and the reality of the United States today that Jefferson is the founding father who cannot be ignored. I hope my listeners will find in this book an increased understanding of Jefferson as a whole, his strengths and weaknesses, and particularly the degree to which his brilliance as a writer is a key to his personality and public service, and to the fact that his words still have meaning and resonance. This book anchors the narrative in Jefferson's growth and development as a writer, the relationship between his literary gifts, his personal life, and his public service. They are an inseparable triad. In this narrative, Jefferson is often holding a pen. It is a dynamic element in his life and career, from his earliest letters to a summary view of the rights of British America, the Declaration of Independence, and Notes on the State of Virginia, to his religious and scientific writings, his inaugural addresses, his correspondence with Washington, Madison, and Adams, his relationships with his wife, daughters, grandchildren, and slaves, his letters to male and female friends, and his brief, self-concealing autobiography. The narrative is biographical but selective. It proceeds chronologically by highlighting key moments when Jefferson had pen in hand. It is a pen used both to show and to hide. This master writer is a master of the shifting line between revealing and concealing from others and himself the complications, inconsistencies, and contradictions between his principles and his policies, between his optimistic view of human nature and the realities of his personal situation and the world he lived in. Jefferson was constantly defining himself by literary acts, from his first letters to his self-created description for his tombstone. Only occasionally did he write explicitly about himself, his feelings, experiences, and relationships, and almost always in letters, which are among his most powerful and revealing writings. To approach Jefferson through his writings helps us to get into his mind and feelings. It contributes to our understanding of his strengths and limitations. It fosters an appreciation of his role as a propagandist of the Revolution, of the way he both made and recorded crucial aspects of the history of the first years of our Republic. This approach shows how Jefferson wrote in different voices to different people and groups. It highlights his ability to change tone and language, as in his addresses to Indian nations, adjusting his appeal to the needs of his audience, and it also allows a focus on Jefferson as a revisionist historian, attempting to mold the historical record in favor of himself and his policies. To focus on what and how he wrote helps us understand his personal and political tensions and reveals the complexity and fullness of his personality. Moreover, it allows us to read and appreciate prose of the highest literary and intellectual quality. It bookmarks Jefferson with Lincoln as a master of the English language. Jefferson was a superb writer with a genius particularly suited to his needs as a Virginia legislator, wartime propagandist, governor, congressional delegate, secretary of state, vice president, president, and the premier intellectual, cultural, and moral voice of the republic he helped create and then lived in for 50 years. Jefferson gave eloquent articulation to the founding ideas of the United States. Many are still the bellwether values of American society. He channeled the widespread sentiment and language of rebellion into a declaration whose first paragraph became a worldwide affirmation of personal liberty and republican government. As a leader in the Virginia legislature, his path-breaking proposals on issues from religious liberty to inheritance reform resonated with a set of values that the country was to embrace over time. And in his few years in the Confederation Congress, his writing talent, his gift for logical organization, concision, and precision, his assiduous work ethic, and his diplomatic tactfulness made him a prominent force in moving disparate interests toward a more unified expression of national priorities. He and his colleagues recognized the need for the Confederated States to have a national Congress responsible for interstate commerce and foreign affairs, though how to do this and how far to go required a consensus difficult to achieve. As the second United States minister to France, Jefferson's work ethic, social amiability, writing skills, and aristocratic bearing made him the right person for the assignment. When, in 1789, he returned to America to become its first Secretary of State, he had already contributed to the making of the new nation what most others would have considered a full career. As Secretary of State and President, he advocated his version of Republican values, emphasizing frugality, decentralization, agriculture, westward expansion, and an extension of the franchise. Jefferson, though, was a public man who preferred his private home to the civic square. He could not, in March 1809, get out of Washington fast enough. Much of his desire for privacy was personal. But he also had intimations of an American future of which he did not approve. He disapproved of the federal court system, especially the Supreme Court, as the unelected determiner of the Constitution's meaning, of the influential role of banks, paper currency, and stock markets in the emerging commercial nation, and of the power of money to influence legislation. He also believed that over time the American people were always right. Jefferson embodies the paradox of an elitist who preached populist rule on the assumption that the people would always elect people like him. In his last decade, with the election of Andrew Jackson, whom he detested, he discovered to his horror that his assumption was wrong. Jefferson died a disillusioned man, touched with an edge of bitterness, so distraught was he by the way in which the country was defining itself. The populace did not always elect the best people. By 1826, the country had rejected his vision of a pastoral republic and was well on its way to embracing financial and industrial activism. In that regard also, he was considerably out of step with history. Even in his own day, Americans cared very much about many things Jefferson thought they should care less about, especially money and material objects, and they had few of Jefferson's scruples about how to get them. He would have been appalled at 21st century America. Chapter 1. My watch had lost its speech. 1743 to 1765. On a cold, sun-struck January day in 1961, at the inauguration of the youngest American president ever, the poet Robert Frost, his white hair touched by the wind, his puckish, elderly face lined with years and griefs, had a message for America. It reached from the present to the past, from one end of the continent to the other. His raspy New England voice was rich with the tones and substance of American history. His gift to John F. Kennedy and to the huge audience he addressed was a poem called The Gift Outright. It is a good poem with which to begin this biography of Thomas Jefferson. The land was ours before we were the land's. She was our land more than 100 years before we were her people. She was ours in Massachusetts, in Virginia. But we were England's, still colonials, possessing what we still were unpossessed by, possessed by what we now no more possessed. Something we were withholding made us weak until we found out that it was ourselves we were withholding from our land of living, and forthwith found salvation in surrender. Such as we were, we gave ourselves outright. The deed of gift was many deeds of war. To the land, vaguely realizing westward, but still unstoried, artless, unenhanced, such as she was, such as she would become. For Jefferson and his contemporaries, the land was everything, and they wanted more of it, more fully than they had it in 1743, the year in which Jefferson was born. They were to get it more fully in the next decades. It was, though, never to be fully enough possessed, as Frost noted, until many wars, treaties, and extensions later. It was to extend from the Atlantic to the Pacific, from the Bering Sea to the Rio Grande. It should have contained, many Americans believed, especially in Jefferson's day, Canada and Cuba. They were near misses. All this, as it was gained, was both a conquest and a bequest. Most Americans believed that some force or power, from God to guns, had given the land to them. It began with Massachusetts and Virginia, the two places where the possessions started in depth and in earnest, and the commitment to be possessed by the possessions gradually became paramount. America began to define itself, its people, and values in terms of the land they occupied, from small farms to plantations, from sea to shining sea. And then, in big cities of the sort that Jefferson not only disapproved of, but thought already were, and would become even more so, black holes of moral degeneration. Eventually, one became the possession of the land one possessed. It was the key to moral values and national character. That was especially so for Virginians. It was from the land itself and from what one built on it that Americans like Jefferson drew their self-identity and sustenance. Americans were more than house-proud. They were land-hungry. From the start, Jefferson called Virginia his country. The Union came afterward. Important as it was for many, especially Southerners, it was a construct, a convenience, until in 1861 it wasn't convenient anymore. The nation that Jefferson helped create was based on the belief in the right of land possession, to have it for oneself with as few restrictions or constraints as possible. It was a legal as well as a moral matter. To grow one's crop and be master of it was the essence of personal and communal pride. Jefferson was the archetype of the house-proud American. Moreover, land ownership by white men included the right to extend ownership and wealth westward, to possess more land to be possessed by. Real estate was the highest form of material wealth. Land wealth was also psychological, spiritual, and self-affirming. It provided self-worth, moral stature, and civic power. Without land ownership, or its equivalent, one did not have the right to vote. The more one had, the better. And one needed private ownership of guns to defend it from enemies, internal and external. In Virginia, the elites, like Jefferson, who owned large.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.